Yes, so good afternoon all. In today's lecture, we will see what is mean by multi-threading, how we implement multi-threading in Java. So let's start our today's session. I will first open Notepad. Okay, so what is multi-threading? So multi-threading in Java is a process of executing multiple threads at a time, means simultaneously, at the same time. Okay, what is meant by that? What is thread? Thread is lightweight process. Okay, so thread is nothing but the lightweight process. Guys, what is the actually idea of that multi-threading? So multi-threading, suppose there is a one program and that program contains two or more different parts or sub-parts or sub-programs, and that sub-programs we have to execute at the same time. Okay, at the same time, that is simultaneously, then that sub-parts or sub-programs of that main program is called as the threads in Java. Okay, so thread is a lightweight process, which is the smallest unit of processing in Java. So main process program is called as the process. What is process? Process is the instance of a program execution. What is process? Process is a instance of a program in execution. Okay, so process is nothing but the instance of a program. So when a program is in the running state, it is called as a process. Okay, now actually multitasking, this is a type of multitasking. Multi-threading is a type of multitasking. So what is multitasking? Multitasking is basically means we have execute several programs simultaneously, several tasks simultaneously. So this ability of the processor is called as the multitasking. So multitasking, guys, divided into two basic types. First type of that multitasking is called as process-based multitasking. And second type of multitasking is called as thread-based multitasking. Okay, great. So what is the difference between that two types? So process-based multitasking. In process-based multitasking, there are number of processes executed simultaneously. Means number of processes. Guys, here, there are number of processes. That is, MS Team is executing simultaneously. I have used this Notepad. Sometimes I have start my music player, or video is also started. Also, there is a WhatsApp and all the things are opened in your web browsers. So these are different processes, and that processes are executed simultaneously. So this type of multitasking is called as process-based multitasking. Okay, great. And this process-based multitasking scheduled by your operating system itself. So process-based multitasking is a feature of operating system, OS. It is called as OS. So let's move to the thread-based multitasking. I hope you understand. What is the example? Example, we always use, that is simultaneously we have to execute number of processes. Okay, what is process? Process means instance of a program in execution, or when a program is in the execution mode, then that is called as the process. Okay, means, and that is handled by your operating system. Scheduling is done by operating system itself. So process based multitasking, that is in our computer we have open number of processes simultaneously. Suppose this is a first process, that is the MS Team is running, as well as Notepad, this process is in the going states, as well as browser is open. These all the processes are executed. Suppose there is a I have played some music on the music player, then all these processes are running simultaneously at the same time. That type of multitasking is called as process based multitasking. Great. Now what is mean by thread based multitasking or multi threading? Okay, so before that, here process based multitasking, what are the some important features? Requires more overhead. Okay, so process based processes are heavyweight task and threads are lightweight task. Okay, and processes are heavyweight means it contains more tasks. Okay, while thread is a lightweight process. Great. Then processes, different processes own their separate address spaces. Okay, while in the thread based multitasking, all the processes share same address space, not a separate address space. In the process based multitasking, intercommunication between two tasks or two processes is more expensive and maybe it is limited. But in the thread based multitasking, inter thread communication is always been possible with less expensive. Okay, so in the thread based multitasking, there is a one process is there, and that process we have to divide into number of sub processes called as a threads. Okay, and these threads are simultaneously in the execution mode. That type of multitasking is called as thread based multitasking. Great. Now multi-threading or thread based multitasking requires less overhead, lightweight processes. Thread means lightweight processes, shares all the threads shares the same address space. Okay, and inter-process communication between these threads are more less expensive. Great. Now Java's interpreter. Okay, so Java's interpreter handles switching between processes, between threads. Okay, great. So thread switching is done by the Java's interpreter in the multi-threading, while the process based multitasking, it's a feature of operating system. Great. I hope you understand. Yes, understood the difference between process based multitasking and thread based multitasking. Let's take one example of thread based multitasking. So what is the example? So example is games. Okay, everyone knows the computer games. In computer games, there are simultaneously graphics is there, then score get updated all the time, while there is some sound play with audios are there. So graphics displaying scores, displaying the scores, playing the audio, all these are the three different threads, and that three different threads are executed simultaneously in your game process. So game is a main process, and that game main process is divided into number of different threads, that is graphics thread, scores thread, and play audio thread. And in this way, these three different threads are executed simultaneously, and that type of multitasking is called as the thread based multitasking, or it is also called as multi-threading. Great. Yes, hope you understand this. Now In this multi-threading, how to create or create the threads? So first, whenever we have to first extend our class using thread class. So thread class is a built-in class in Java and present in which package? So thread class is present in the java.lang.thread. Okay. So thread is class, and that class is present in the java.lang package. Okay, Java is the main package. Inside that sub package is a lang. So in the java.lang package, thread classes exist. Yes. So how to create the any class as a thread class? So either you have to extend it from the thread class, or there is a another way to create the multi-threading class by implementing runnable interface. Okay, great. So why that the second way is used? Yes, there is also when suppose the class A is already extends from B class. Great. So if A class is already extends from B class, in Java there is no way to implement. Again, we don't write extends from thread class. It is extends from thread. Okay, so extends from thread, we cannot write like this, or there is no provision in the Java to extends two classes. Two classes are inherited into a single class, means a child class does not having two parent class. That is the real life concept. So this is not possible in Java, because if a class is already extends from some B class and we want to make that A class as a thread class, so there is no another way to make that A class as a thread class. So in that case, what we have to do, we have to implement. Yes, we know multiple inheritance is supported in Java, but one class and one interface. So implements runnable. Okay, so using this way, we have to create or make the class A as a runnable, means a thread class. Okay, so interface name is a runnable. Great, hope you understand this. So we will first create the thread classes by extending thread class. Okay, now what is the way? First, we have to create our class A as a thread class by extending it from the thread class. Second thing, implement run method. So second thing is implement run method. So we have to implement run method. Actually, it is a run method is present into the runnable interface and as well as thread class. So when we implement it, means we can override this run method in our class, and whatever we have to write the body of the run method, that code body of run method. Okay, so that code must be executed in simultaneous way. So second thing to run, implement run method that is responsible for execution of code through the thread. Threads execute that run method's body. Okay, so third step is to start the thread, and to start the thread, we have to use start method. Which method? Start method. We have to use start method. So object of the thread class, object of the thread class dot start method. So this is the third step, and when we call this object thread of the object and call the start method, actually it calls the run method, because This is the start method, also the method of the thread class, okay, which is actually present already. Their source code is available, which is present in the java.lang package, and that thread class consists of start method, and in the start method itself calls to the run method, okay. So automatically it calls to the run method. Guys, don't call object thread.run here, otherwise that method is not in the multi-threading. So third way to start the object, this start method calls the object of the thread class, which is newborn, and goes to the active state. We will see the life cycle of the thread class later on. Guys, hope you understand this. Now it's time to create our code. So I have created one new file, new. Yes. Okay. So same code, I will delete it. Otherwise, I have to write comment for that, multi-line comment. Okay. Yes. So from here, I have to start writing the code. Actually, thread class is present in the java.lang package, and we know that java.lang package are by default imported in our program. So no need to write import java.lang.thread. Okay, it is by default imported. So class A, I want to make it as a thread class. So extends from the thread. Great. Inside that, I have to write the run method. So we have to override it. So write the access specifier as a public void run. So we have to override this run method. Then write the body of run method. For the simplicity, we have to write the code of loop. Suppose integer I is equal to 1. I less than equal to 10, so or 5, and I plus plus. Okay. Then inside the for loop, I have to write system dot out dot println. Okay. And from thread A, and the message I is equal to double quotes complete plus I. Okay, this is the message inside the for loop. Great. When this total loop is execution is completed, then I have to write system dot out dot println. Okay, and write the message at exit from a class. Okay, exit from a class. Great. And complete the run method, then complete the thread class. Okay, so class A, we have to create it, class A, which is a thread class, because which is extends from the thread. Now we have to create our new class, class B, which is we want to make that B class also multi-threaded class. So we have to extend it from the thread class. Yes. Again, in this class B, we have to implement public void run method. Okay. Inside the run method, we have to again write some messages to check whether that two threads are executed simultaneously or not. So I have to copy this same code and paste here. So for I, okay, from thread B, I is equal to plus I, exit from B class. Great. So in this way, we have to create a two thread class. Now we have create class MyThread. Okay, so inside the MyThread class, we have to write our main method. What is the main method's access specifier? Public static void main string args. Okay, and create the object of class A. So how to create object of A? Class A is equal to the name of the object OB, or I think we have to give the name as A itself, object of A class, new, and call the constructor of the A class. Great. So this line creates the object, and this memory is reserved on the heap partition, and their base reference is cached into a reference variable. Generally, we have to call that the reference variable, or it is a actually object. Okay, so next, create the object of B class. B is equal to new B semicolon. So now A dot, we have to call the start method. Guys, always remember, in the multi-threading, when you want to make the code in the multi-threaded, then you have to call to the start method. This start method is actually present into the thread class, actually present in the thread class. So when you call A dot start, here we have to extend the thread class, so their public methods are inherited into the A class. And in the thread class, when you call the start method, first the environment is created for the multitasking for that object A, and that thread, that is now A is a one thread, B is a another thread, and main is a third thread. So total, how many threads are there in your program? Total threads are present in our program. Okay. And only one process is there. Okay. So one process, we have to divide it into three different processes. One is the main process, A and B, sub processes. Okay. That is called as threads. So main, A and B, these are the three threads. This A, B and main. Okay, main instance. Okay, I will show you that also. Then A dot start actually calls to the start method. Inside the start method, first code is to make the environment for the threading, multi-threading, and then calls the run method inside that. So when you call the start method, automatically run method get executed. Before that, it creates the environment for the multi-threading, okay, for that particular thread object. Great. Then B dot start. Great. Next, complete the main method, complete the class MyThread. Yes, so complete it. Next, you have to write one message here, that is system dot out dot println, and write the message exit from main. Okay, so this is the message. Great. Guys, now there are the three different threads are available in your program, and these different three threads are, when they, you can call the A dot start and B dot start, these two threads are in the running or runnable queue, that is the active state, and this main thread is already in active state. So these three threads, when they allocated the processor, they are in the running state and they execute some part of their code, and that is displayed. Guys, in multi-threading, we cannot predict the output because that this statement is executed 5 times as well as this statement is executed 5 times. But when, we don't know, because it is not the sequential like that A dot start. So on first, this run method is called and A's all code is executed. It is not done in the multi-threading because these are the simultaneously working main thread A and B thread. Great. So now we will predict and don't predict the output here. Just save it. Okay. So save it by using my thread. Okay. Dot Java. And save into the Java programs folder. Great. So go to the Java programs folder. Write the CMD command prompt. Open the command prompt first. Okay, this is your command prompt. Then write Java C, name of the program, that is my thread dot Java. Okay, check whether there is any error. No error. So interpret it, my thread, press enter. Great. So what is the code output of this program? So first exit from main. Okay, from yes, I hope you visible this code. So A, then B, then A, B, A, B, A, B. Okay, like this. So means here from exit from main, actually main is initially in the running state. That means processor is allocated. Then it switches to the thread A, means A got the processor. It executes some lines of code. Then B got the processor and that executes some line of code like this and like this. Okay. So at the last exit from A class, B class. Okay, great. So always it is not predicted that the way same way you have to execute it. Okay. Sometimes if we want to make start stop. Okay. That we'll see later on. Before that, I will show you one. Okay. So this is the state transition diagram of the thread, or it is called as the thread life cycle. So there are total 5 states. One is the newborn state, then start or active state, then dead state, then block state. So these are different states in your Java. So newborn, actually active state, this is divided into 2, running and runnable. Running means when the processor is allocated to that particular thread, then that state is called as running state. When the thread is in the waiting state, that is ready to run, but processor is busy, that's why processor is not allocated to that particular thread. So this is called as the runnable state, ready to run state. That is called as the ready to run state. So these 2 states are merged together into the active state. Great. So newborn state, running state, runnable state, dead state, and block state. These are the different 5 states of the thread life cycle. Great. So when newborn state, when you create the object of the thread class, at that time the thread is in the newborn state. When you call the start method through that object dot start, then it is in the active state. Maybe it is running, the thread got the running state or unable. It depends. If the processor is in the free and the newborn thread directly goes to the running state, otherwise it got the runnable, it is waiting in the runnable queue, okay, or runnable state. Great. Whenever running state thread is yield, then it goes to the runnable states for the waiting, because there are number of scheduling algorithms for the processor, that is time slicing. As the basis of time slicing, that much time the thread is executed and other part of the remaining part of the execution is done afterwards. Like this, suppose 5 millisecond is the time slice, only each thread got the 5 millisecond time to execute, and after that the thread is yield and it goes to the runnable state. Great. In the active thread state, if we apply suspend, sleep or wait method, then that thread get blocked, means in the ideal state. Thread goes into ideal state. Okay, so when the thread goes into ideal state, if we apply suspend method and that method the thread got blocked state, then you have to use resume method to resume that suspended thread. If the sleep method is there, then there is a time slice. So time as per the millisecond time we have passed into sleep method, that is exist, then it is automatically goes to the active thread state. And when you wait method, then you notify that waited thread by using notify method, and that thread goes to the active state. Great. Now, last, using stop method, in any state we can make the call the stop method on that thread, and that thread goes to the dead state. Okay, that means thread is killed. Great. Like this, this is the state transition diagram for the thread or thread's life cycle. Okay, hope you understand. When you create a thread object, the thread is born and is said to be in the newborn state. That is the first. Great. Runnable state or ready to run state, that is the second. Okay. Initially, it goes to the runnable state. When the processor is free and allocated to that particular thread, then it goes to the runnable running state. And again, by using yield method, we have to resume it into the runnable state. Okay. So this is all about the life cycle of thread. I hope you understand all these things. Okay. So let's move to the next part. Yes. So let's move to the what are the different methods present in the thread class. So guys, we will see what are the different methods. Different methods present in thread class. So yes, so there are number of methods which are present in the thread class. There is one option, we know that our Java source code is open source code. So just go to the your JDK lib. Okay, I will show you Java JDK lib library. In the library, there is a source code zip folder is there. You can just extract it. Then SRC, that is source code, is there. So just go to the Java base, that is base classes are present in that sub package, that is Java, and that package contains sub package that again lang. Then search for the thread class and open this thread class. Okay, so open with. Okay, so this is a thread class, all the code is visible to you everywhere. There is all the class methods are also present. Run method is also there, as well as start method is also there. If you search, so start method is also there. New thread dot start and start method, actually their implementation is also there. So let's check it from here. What is the how the start method is started and start. This is all about the open source code. So you will see all the methods and their implementation. All the supportive classes are present in the lang package. Great. So we will see the main get name. Okay. So get name method. What is the use of get name method? If you want to obtain the name of any thread, then you can use get name method. So you know that what is the name of your thread. Get priority. get priority method. This method is useful to get the priority of the thread. Default priority of the thread is 5. Okay. And minimum priority of the thread is 1 and maximum priority of the thread is 10 by default. Okay. So this is the get priority method. If you want to set any other name to that thread, so there is a one method called as set name. Using set name method, we can give the set the name to that particular thread also. We have to set priority. Okay, so set priority. If you want to set priority other than 1, 5 or 10, you can give the priority as per your requirement. Then there is a stop method. Okay, so stop method we will apply at any time in the life cycle. Great. Then another method is called as slip. Okay, so when you pass the millisecond time, okay, millisecond time, at that time that thread got the block state. When the time is expires, it goes back to the original active state. That means either running or unable state. Great. Run method, we know. Start method, suspend and resume. Suspend is also one method, as well as there is another method called as resume. Okay. So resume is another method. Great. So these are number of methods are there which are present. So we will see one by one. First, we will see that how to find that main thread, having the main thread, what is the name of that main thread, what is the current thread of our program. So for that purpose, first I have to give comment to all these lines. Okay. Then, okay, so first I will save it. Okay, I have to create new file for the new class, suppose class main thread. Okay, so how to find there is a main thread? Yes, every program, okay, prior to this multi-threading, whatever we seen, that is, there is only one thread, that is multi-threading, that is single threading programming. Okay, so just see public void main. Okay, one thing, static void main, then write string args, you can give any name. Inside main method, just create thread t is equal to thread dot current thread. So this current thread method, which is static one, that's why we have to call that method by using class name. So thread dot current thread. So when this line is executed, which thread executes this line, their reference is stored into the T thread class object. Now when you display that, yes, system dot out dot println thread and write current thread is equal to and plus t. Great. Complete the main method, complete your main thread class. So guys, let's save it using main thread dot java, main thread dot java. Save it into the Java program file. Okay, and just now, okay, so now we have to write the name of that particular class, that is main thread dot java, and press enter. Okay, it's compiled successfully. Then write Java, that is Java's interpreter, main thread. So every program having one thread that is called as main thread, that thread name is also main thread, and the group name of that thread class is also a main thread. So let's press enter and check it. What is the output of this program? So guys, what is the output? That is current thread is equal to thread. Okay, so this is the class in that main. Main is the name of the thread, that is main thread. 5 is the default priority of that thread because we cannot set it. That's why. And the third main argument, that is the thread group. So that may, that thread, current thread is present into main thread. Great. Yes, guys, hope you understand. Yes or no? Yes, hope you understand. Yes, Fazal.
Done, sir.
Okay. Yes, let's. Now, we know different methods. So, if you want to set some, suppose T dot, we know the reference, this T. What is the thread T? T is the main thread. Currently, this stores the reference of main thread. Now, set the name. Set name. Which method is there? T dot set name. Suppose we want to set the name as my thread. Okay. So main thread is the name of the current thread, but I want to set it as a my thread. Yes, it's possible. And if you want to check it, then again you can write same statement, system.out.println current thread is plus t. So it gives you, instead of main here, instead of main, that is the name of the thread, my thread is displayed. Let's check it. First save it properly. Now compile it and run it. Great. So first line gives you first main 5. Okay. Then when you set the name for that thread, then that thread name is my thread and group of the thread is main. Yes, it remains same. Priority remains same. Great. Okay. Now, in this way, you can set the priority also. Okay. You can check the priority also. You can set the priority T dot set priority. Suppose you want to set priority of that particular thread as 10. Okay. Then you can set it. And if you want to display only priority, okay. So how to get it in this way is integer p, p for priority, and call the method, that is t dot get prior. Priority. So P gives the priority, that is 10. If you want to display it, you can use system.out.println. Okay. And print new priority of the thread is equal to plus. Now let's save it properly. Open the command prompt. Compile it first. Oh, there is something missing. What is method get priority? T dot get priority. What it returns? It returns the priority. So method get priority variable T of type thread error. Okay. So something spelling mistake is there. Yes. Okay. Yes. P is small. Yes. Yes. Okay. So let's check it. Get priority. Yes. As per the nomenclature for the method, first letter is small and consecutive words letter is capital. Yes. So let's save it. File it properly. Yes, there is no error. Now check it. So new priority of the thread is 10. Initial 5, but when we change it, it becomes 5. If you want to print all the information of the current thread, then just copy it and paste it here. So there are 4 statement which gives the output. So we have to save it properly. Then again, compile it. Okay. And again, execute it. So it gives current thread at the third line. Thread name is my thread. Priority get changed. That is 10. And group of the thread is the main. Great. So hope you understand, guys. Now in this way, we have to see number of problem statements. Okay. Now in the prior, we open the So I have to close that and open the first thread. Okay, main thread, my thread. Okay, which class is there? My thread. Okay. So this is our previous first program. Yes. So here we have to created class A, in that run method is implemented, class B where run method is implemented. Now we have to see different things. For example, here we have want yield method. If you know the yield method, if I is equal to 1, just call the yield method, yield. Okay, don't write any object name because it is inherited. Class A is inherited from the thread class and the yield method is inside the thread class, which is inherited in the class A. So no need to write anything. This is by default, this dot yield method. Okay, so yield means it goes to the which state? Blocked state. When I is equal to 1, it goes to the block state, yield. Oh, okay. Not yield means it goes to the from running to runnable state. Okay, so it's wait for runnable queue using this yield method. Great. So here in the class B, what we have to do, use the slip method. Okay, so slip method means whenever we use the slip method, which always raise the exception, which throws the exception. So whenever the any method throws the exception, that method must write in the try clash block. Okay. So slip gives the time in millisecond. So 1000 milliseconds. Okay. Then complete the try catch block. So catch, write the name of the exception class. So exception, which is super class, exception E. Yes. And then write one message if you want. Okay, otherwise just remains it empty. Great. So if exception is there, then it goes to the catch block, otherwise it executes. Okay. So like this, we can sleep the thread for some time. How many time? That is 1000 milliseconds. Let's check, save it. Okay. Now the output is varies. Okay. If you also, you can stop the thread, sleep the thread. Okay. We will see first that, and then Java my thread dot java. Okay, compile it. Okay, invalid use of the restricted identifier yield. Okay, great. So to invoke the method called yield, qualify the yield with the receiver of type name. Okay, so instead of yield, we can write if I is equal to 3, what we have to do, we have to call the stop method, means we have to make the thread as a dead. Okay, instead of that, we have to call at the stop method. Okay, save it properly. Okay, so let's execute my thread. So let's observe the output. Exit from main, that is main thread's last line. Then from A, I is equal to 1, main thread I is equal to A is equal to 2. And then B get executed and then B class. Because what we will make the thread dead by using stop method. So if I becomes 3, it becomes dead and that thread is exit from the our process. Okay, great. Guys, hope you understand what is mean by the multi-threading and how we can apply the multi-threading. Output of the multi-threading is varies as per the scheduling done by the interpreter and the internally it is done by the operating system itself. Okay. Yes, any doubts till this? Great. Hope you understand this